she's a bright new latter. Hey, roll and go. She drinks rum and shoots tobacco. Spend my money on Sally Brown. Sally Brown, she has a daughter. Hey, roll and go. Set me sailing across the water. Send my money on Sally Brown. Sally Brown, I'm bound to leave you. Hey, roll and go. Sally Brown, I'll not deceive you. Spend my money on Sally Brown. When the sea is hence, what care these roarers for the name of king? To cabin, silence, trouble is not.
Nay, good, remember whom thou hast before.
None that I care for more than myself. Go, make ready in your cabin for the mischance of the hour, if so hap. Cheerly, my good boys, cheerly. Clear the way, I say.
I take great comfort from this fellow. He thinks he hath no drowning mark upon him. his complexion is perfect gallows. That bastard made to his hanging. Let the rope of his destiny be our cable for our own that little advantage.
Down with the top boss! Yeah! Lower! Lower! Bring out to bring it out high with the main of force. And a plague on this howling! First of the storm! Or our office! What? Yet again? What do you here? Shall we give o'er and drown? Have you a mind to sink?
Pox your throat, you bawling, blasphemous, incharitable dog!
Fuck you then!
Hang her! Hang you, horse and insolent noisemaker! We're less afraid to be drowned than thou art!
I'll warrant him for drowning! He'll be no stronger than a nutshell, and as leaky as an unstaunched wench!
No! Lay her to hold! To hold! Set her two courses to windward again. Lay her off! Shall our mouths be cold?
The king and prince are at prayers. Let's assist them, for our case is as theirs.
I am out of patience!
We are merely cheated of our lives by drunkards. This white chap rascal, would thou mightst lie drowning the washing of 10 times?
I'll be hanged yet, though every drop of water swear against it, and gape at widest and glutton.
Let's all sit with the king.
Let's take our leave of him.
Oh, now would I give 1,000 furlongs of sea for an acre of barren ground. Long furs, brown heath, anything. The will's above be done, but I would fain die a dry death.
The welkin's cheek dashes the fire out. I have suffered with those that I saw suffer. A brave vessel that had no doubt some noble creature in her. Dashed all to pieces. The cry did knock against my very heart. Souls. They perished. Had I been any god of power, I would have sunk the sea within the earth, or ere it should the good ship so have swallowed.
Be collected! No more amazement! Tell your piteous heart there's no harm done!
Woe the day!
No harm! I have done nothing but in care of thee. Thee, my dear one. Thee, my daughter, who art ignorant of what thou art, not knowing of whence I am, nor that I am more better than Prospero, master of a full poor cell, and thy no greater father.
More to know did never meddle with my thoughts.
'Tis time I should inform thee farther. Here, lend thy hand. Pluck my magic garment from me. So. Lie there, my art. Wipe thou thine eyes, have comfort. The direful spectacle of the wreck, which touched the very virtue of compassion in thee, I have with such provision in mine art, so safely ordered, there is no soul. No, not so much perdition as a hair be tinted to any creature in the vessel, which thou heardst cry, which thou sawst sink. Sit down, for thou must now no farther.
You have often begun to tell me what I am, but stopped and left me to a bootless inquisition, concluding, stay, not yet.
The hour's now come. The very minute bids thee ope thy ear, obey, and be attentive. Canst thou remember a time before we came unto this cell? I do not think thou canst, for then thou wast not out 3 years old.
Certainly, sir, I can. Tis far off. And rather like a dream than an assurance my remembrance warrants. Had I not 4 or 5 women once that attended me?
Thou hast, and more, Miranda. 12 years since, Miranda. 12 years since. Thy father was the Duke of Milan and the Prince of Power.
Sir, I'm not you, my father.
Thy mother was a piece of virtue, and she said thou wast my daughter. And thy father was Duke of Milan.
Oh, the heavens! What foul play had we that we came from thence? Or blessed was it we did?
Both, my girl.
Please you, farther.
My brother and thine uncle, called Antonio. I pray thee mark me that a brother should be so perfidious. He whom next thyself of all the world I loved, and to him put the manage of my state, as at that time it were the first, Prospero, the prime duke, being so reputed in dignity, and for the liberal arts without a parallel, those being all my study, the government I cast upon my brother, and to my state grew stranger, being transported and enwrapped in secret studies. Thy false uncle, dost thou attend me?
Oh, sir, most heedfully.
Having once perfected how to grant suits, how to deny them, who to advance, and who to trash for o'ertopping, new created the creatures that were mine, I say, or changed them, or new formed them. Having both the key of officer and office set all hearts in this state to what tune pleased his ear, thou attendest not.
Oh, good sir, I do.
I pray thee, mark me. I, thus neglecting worldly ends, all dedicated to closeness and the bettering of my mind, in my false brother awaked an evil nature. And my trust, like a good parent, did beget of him a falsehood in its contrary as great as my trust was, which had indeed no limit, a confidence sans bound. He, being thus lorded, made such a sinner of his memory to credit his own lie. He did believe he was indeed the Duke, dost thou hear?
Your tale, sir, would cure deafness.
Me, poor man, my library was dukedom large enough. Of temporal royalties, he thinks me now incapable, conspires with the King of Naples to give him annual tribute, to pay him homage, to subject his coronet to his crown, and bend the dukedom yet unbowed, alas, poor Milan, to most ignoble stupid.
Oh, the heavens!
Mark his condition and the event, then say if this might be a brother.
I should sin to think but nobly of my grandmother. Good wombs have borne bad sons.
Now, the condition. This King of Naples, being an enemy to me inveterate, hearkens my brother's suit, which was that he, in lieu of the premises of homage and I know not how much tribute, should should extirpate me and mine out of the dukedom and confer Fair Millen with all the honors on my brother. Whereon, one midnight, a treacherous army levied, did Antonio, fated to the purpose, open the gates of Millen. And in the dead of darkness, the ministers for the purpose hurried thence me and thy crying self.
Thou lack the pity! I, not remembering how I cried out then, shall cry it over again. Bah! It is a hint that rings mine eyes to it. Wherefore did they not that hour destroy us?
Well demanded, wench. My tale provokes that question. Dear, they durst not, so dear the love my people bore me, nor set a mark so bloody on this business. In few, they hurried us aboard a bark, bore us some leagues to sea, where they prepared a rotten carcass of a boat, not rig nor tackle, sail nor mast, the very rats instinctively had quitted. There they hoist us, to cry to the sea that roared to us, to sigh to the winds, whose pity sighing back again, did us but loving wrong.
Alack, what trouble was I then to you?
Oh, a cherubim thou wast that didst preserve me. Thou didst smile, infused with a fortitude from heaven, that raised in me the undergoing stomach to bear up against what should ensue.
How came we ashore?
By providence divine. Some food we had, some fresh water, that a noble Neapolitan, Gonzalo, out of his charity, being then appointed master of this design, did give us with fresh linens, stuffs, necessaries that since have steaded much. So of his gentleness, knowing I loved my books, he furnished me from mine own library with volumes I love above mine own dukedom.
Would I might but ever see that man.
Now I arise. Sit down. Hear the rest of our sea storm. Here on this island we arrived, and here have I, thy schoolmaster, made thee more prophet than other princesses can that have more tutors who are not so good as I.
Heavens thank you for it. And now, I pray you, sir, for still, 'tis beating in my mind, your reason for raising the sea storm.
No, thus far forth, by accident most strange, bountiful fortune, now my dear lady hath mine enemies brought to this shore. And by my prescience I find my zenith doth depend upon a most auspicious star, whose influence if now I court not, but omit, my fortunes will ever after droop. Here, cease more questions, thou art inclined to sleep. Here's a good dullness, give it way, I know thou canst not choose. Come away, servant, come. I am ready now. Approach my Ariel. Come!
All hail, great master, grave sir, hail. I come to answer thy best pleasure, be it to fly, to swim, to ride on the curled clouds, to thy strong bidding task Ariel and all her quality.
Hast thou, spirit, performed to point the tempest that I bade thee?
To every article. I boarded the king's ship, now in the deck, now in the beak, the waist, in every cabin I flamed amazement. Sometimes I divide and burn in many places. On the yards, the topmast, the bowsprit, I flamed distinctly and then meet and join. Jove's lightning, the precursor of the great thunderclap, more momentary in sight outrunning were not. The fire and cracks of sulphurous roaring, the most mighty Neptune seemed to besiege and make his bold waves tremble, yea, his dread tried and shake.
My brave spirit! Who was so firm, so constant, that this coil would not infect his reason?
Not a soul, but felt the fever of the mad and played some tricks of desperation. All the mariners quit the vessel and plunged into the foaming brine. Then all afire with me, the king's son Ferdinand, with hair upstanding, more like reeds, not hair, was the first man that leapt and cried, "Hell is empty and all the devils are here!"
Ah, that's my spirit! But was not this nigh shore?
Close by, master.
But are they, Ariel, safe?
Not a hair perished, and on their sustaining garments, not a blemish, but fresher than before. And as thou badest me, in troops I have dispersed them about the isle. The king's son Ferdinand I have left in an odd angle of the isle, sitting, cooling of the air and sighs, with his arms in this sad knot.
Of the king's ship, the mariners, say how thou hast disposed, and the rest of the fleet.
Safely in harbor is the king's ship, and the rest of the fleet, there on the Mediterranean float, bound sadly home for Naples, supposing they saw the king's ship wrecked, and his great person perished.
Ariel, thy charge exactly is performed. But there's more work. What is the time of the day?
Past the mid-season.
At least two glasses. The time twixt six and now must by both of us be spent most preciously.
Is there more toil? Since thou dost give me pains, let me remember thee what thou hast promised me, which is not yet performed.
How now, Moody? What is thou canst demand?
My liberty.
Before the time be out, no more.
I prithee, let me remember thee that I have done thee worthy service, told thee no lies, served without grumble or grudge. Thou did promise to bait me a full year.
Dost thou forget from what a torment I did free thee?
No, sir.
Thou hast, liest, malignant thing. Hast thou forgot that foul witch Sycorax?
No, sir.
Who with age and envy was grown into a hoop? Hast thou forgot her?
I did not, sir.
Thou dost. When was she born? Where was she born?
In Argiers, sir.
Oh, was she so? I must once in a month recount what thou hast been which thou forgetst. This damned witch Sycorax, for mischiefs manifold, for sorceries terrible to enter a human hearing, was from Algiers, thou knowest, banished. Is not this true?
Aye, sir.
Yes. This blue-eyed hag was hither brought with child, and here was left by the sailors. Thou, my slave, was then her servant. And for thou wast a spirit too delicate to act her earthy and abhorred commands, refusing her grand hests, she did confine thee in her most unmitigable rage into a cloven pile, within which whiff, imprisoned, thou didst painfully remain a dozen years, which in which time she died and left thee there, while thou didst vent thy groans as fast as mill wheels strike. Then was this island save for the sun she littered here, freckled whelp hagborn.
Aye, Caliban, her son.
Aye, dull thing, I say, that Caliban, whom now I keep in service. Thou best know'st what torment I did find thee in. Thy groans did make wolves howl and penetrate the breast of ever-angry bears. It was a torment to lay upon the damned, which Sycorax could not again undo. It was mine art, when I arrived and heard thee, that made gape the pine and let thee out.
Oh, I thank you, master, I thank you.
If thou more murmurest, I will rend an oak and peg thee in his knotty entrails till thou hast howled away 12 winters.
No, I promise to do my spiriting gently and be correspondent.
Do so, and after 2 days, I will discharge thee.
Oh, that's my noble master said. What shall I do? What shall I
go,
do?
Go. Make thyself like a nymph of the sea. Be subject to no sight, but thine and mine invisible to every eyeball else. Go. Hence, with diligence. Awake, dear heart. Awake, thou hast slept well. Awake!
weirdness of your tale put a heaviness in me.
Shake it off. Come on. We'll visit Caliban, my slave, who never offers us kind answer.
'Tis a villain, sir. I do not like to look on.
But as 'tis, we cannot miss him. He does make our fire, fetch in our wood, and serves in offices that profit us. What ho! Slave! Caliban! Thou earth, thou! Speak!
There's wood enough within!
Come forth, I say, there's other business for thee. Come, thou tortoise, when? Thou poisonous slave, got by the devil himself upon thy wicked dam, come forth!
Wicked do as e'er my mother brushed with raven's feather from unwholesome fen drop on you both! Southwest blow on ye and blister ye o'er!
For this tonight be sure thou shalt have cramps. Thou shalt be stitched up. Thou shalt be pinched as thick as honeycomb. Eek, pinch, more stinging than bees that made 'em.
I must eat my dinner. This island's mine! By Sycorax, my mother, which thou takest from me! When thou camest first, thou strokest me and madest much of me, wouldst give me water with berries in, and teach me how to name the bigger light, and how the less that burn by day and night. And then I loved thee. I showed thee all the qualities of the earth. The fresh springs, the brine pits, the barren place and fertile. Cursed be that I did so. All the charms of Sycorax, toads, beetles, bats, light on you. For I am all the subjects that you have, which first was mine. Own king, and here you stymie me in this hard rock, whilst you do keep from me the rest of the island.
Thou most lying slave, whom stripes may move, not kindness, I have used thee, filth as thou art, with human care, lodge thee in mine own cell, till thou dost seek to violate the honor of my child.
Wouldn't have been done. Thou did prevent me.
Abhorrent slave!
I had peopled elf this isle with Caliban.
I pitied thee, took pains to make thee speak, taught thee each hour one thing or other, when thou didst not savage, know thine own meaning, but wast gabbled like a thing most brutish. I endowed thy purposes with meaning to make them known, but thy vile race, though thou didst learn, had that int. Which good natures could not abide to be with. Therefore wast thou deservedly confined into this cell, who hast deserved more than a prison.
You taught me language. My prophet aunt is, I know how to curse. The red plague rid you for learning me your language.
Hands, straight hands! Fetch us and few and be quick about it. That our best answer of the business. Shrugs thou malice? If thou neglect'st or dost unwillingly what I command, I'll fill thee with all cramps, rack all thy bones with aches, and make thee roar,
no!
That beasts shall tremble at thy den.
No!
Roar!
Pretty! I must obey. His art is of such power. It would control my dam's god, Cenobus, and make a vessel of him.
So, slave, hence!
should this music be? In the air or the earth? It sounds no more, and sure waits some god of the island, sitting on a bank, weeping again. The king, my father, Rick. This music crept by me upon the waters, allaying both the fury and my passion with its sweet air. Thence, I have followed it, or it had drawn me, rather. But it's gone. No, it begins again. Does remember my drowned father. This is no mortal beast, and you're no sound that the earth owes. I hear it now above me.
The fringed curtains of thine eye advance, and say what thou seest yon.
What is it? A spirit? Lord, how it looks about. Believe me, sir, it carries a brave form, but 'tis a spirit.
No, wench. It eats and sleeps and hath such senses as we have such. This gallant, who thou seest, was in the wreck. And but he's something stained with grief, that's beauty's canker. Thou mightst call him a goodly person. He hath lost his fellows and strays about to find them.
I might call him a thing divine. For nothing natural I ever saw so noble.
It goes on, I see, as my soul prompts it. Spirit, fine spirit, I'll set thee free for this.
Monsieur, the goddess, of whom these airs attend, vouchsafe my prayers. May I know if you remain upon this island, and if you will some good instruction give how I may bear me here. My prime request, which I do last pronounce, is, oh, you wonder if you be made or no?
No wonder, sir, but certainly a maid.
My language, heavens, I'm the best of them that speak this speech. Were I but where 'tis spoken.
How the best? What wert thou if the king of Naples heard thee?
A single thing as I am now that wonders, to hear thee speak of Naples. He does hear me, and that he does, I weep myself on Naples, who with mine eyes never since I have beheld the king, my father, Rick.
Alack for mercy!
Yes, faith, and all his lords.
At the first sight, they have changed eyes. Delicate Ariel, I'll set thee free for this. Good sir, word, good sir. I fear you have done yourself some wrong.
Why speaks my father so ungently? This is the third man that e'er I saw. The first that e'er I sighed for. Pity move my father to be inclined my way.
If a virgin in your affection not got forth, I will make you the queen of Naples.
Soft, sir, one word more. They have both in each other's powers. But this swift business I must uneasy make, lest too light winning make the prize light. A word, sir! I charge thee that thou attend me. Thou dost here usurp the name thou owest not, and hast put thyself upon this island as a spy to win it from me, the Lord armed.
No, as I am a man.
There's nothing ill can dwell in such a temple. If ill spirits have so fair a house, good things will strive to dwell within it.
Come, follow. Speak not for him. He's a traitor. Come, sir. Ah, manacle thy neck and feet together. Sea water shalt thou drink. Thy food shall be the fresh brook mussels, withered roots.
No! I will resist such a detainment till my name has more power.
Oh, dear father, make not too rash a trial of him, for he is gentle and not fearful.
What I say, my foot, my tutor? Put up thy ward, who makes the show but dares not strike. Thy conscience is so possessed with guilt. Come from thy ward, for I can here disarm thee with this stick and make thy weapon drop.
Beseech you.
Hence, hang not on my garments.
Sir, happy. I'll be his surety.
Silence. One word more shall make me hate thee and chide thee. What? An advocate for an impostor? Thou thinkst there is no more such shapes as he, having seen but him and Caliban? Foolish wench, to the most of men, this is a Caliban, and they to him are angels.
My affections are then most humble. I have no ambition to see a goodlier man.
Come, obey. Thy nerves are in their infancy again, and hath no vigor in them.
Oh, so they are. My spirits, as in a dream, are all bound up now. My father lost, the weakness which I feel, the wreck of all my friends, nor these man threats to whom I'm subdued, are but lie to me. Might I but through my prison once a day behold this maid, all corners held on the earth, let liberty make use of. Space enough have I in such prison.
It works. Hey, follow me. Ariel, thou hast done well. Come on.
Be of comfort. My father's of a better nature, sir, than he appears by speech. This is unwonted, which now came from him.
Thou shalt be free as mountain winds, but first exactly do all points of my command.
To the syllable.
Come, follow. Speak not you for him.
Dollar comes to him indeed. You have spoken truer than you purpose.
You have taken it wisier than I meant you should.
Therefore, my lord.
Fie, what a spendthrift is he of his tongue.
The spare. Well, I have, but yet.
He will be talking.
Which, of he or Adrienne, for a good wager, first begins to crow?
The old cock?
The cockerel.
Done. The wager?
A laughter.
A match.
So you're paid.
Uninhabitable and almost inaccessible.
Yet.
Yet.
You could not miss it.
It must needs be of subtle, tender, and delicate temperance. The air breathes upon us here most sweetly.
As if it had lungs and rotten ones.
Or as 'twere perfumed by a fen.
Here is everything advantageous to life.
True. Save any means to live.
Of that there's none, or little.
How lush and lusty the grass looks. How green.
The ground indeed is tawny.
with an eye of green in it.
He misses not much.
No, but he doth mistake the truth totally.
But the rarity of it is, which is indeed almost beyond belief,
as many vouched rarities are,
is that our garments, being as they were drenched in the sea, hold notwithstanding their freshness and their glosses, being rather new dyed than stained with salt water. Methinks our garments are now as fresh as when we put them on first in Africa, at the marriage of the king's fair daughter Claribel to the king of Tunis.
'Twas a sweet marriage. We prosper well in our return.
Tunis was never graced with such fair gown to their queen.
Sir, we were talking that our garments are as fresh as when we wore them at Tunis at the marriage of your daughter, who is now queen. Is not my doublet as fresh as when I first wore it? I mean, in a sort.
That sort was well fished for.
When I wore it at your daughter's marriage.
You cram these words into mine ears against the stomach of my senses. Would that I had never married my daughter there, for coming thence, my son is lost. And my rate, she too, who is so far from Italy removed, I ne'er again shall see her. Thou, mine heir of Naples and of Milan, what strange fish hath made his meal on thee?
Sir, he may live. I saw him bid the surges under him and ride upon their backs. He trod the water, whose enmity he flung aside, and breasted the surge more swollen that met him. His bold head but the contentious waves he kept, and oared himself with his good arms and lusty stroke to the shore, that all his wave-worn bases bowed as stooping to relieve him. I not doubt he came alive to land.
No! No, no. He's gone.
Sir, you may thank yourself for this great loss. You would not bless our Europe with your daughter, but rather lose her to an African, where at least she has cause to wet the grief on it.
Prithee, peace.
You were kneeled to and importuned otherwise by all of us, and the fair soul herself, weighed between loathness and obedience, at which end of the beam should bow. We have lost your son, I fear, forever. Milan and Naples have more widows in this business making than we bring men to comfort them. The fault's your own.
And so is the dearest of the lost.
My Lady Sebastiana, the truth you speak doth lack some gentleness and time to speak it in. You rub the sore rather than bringing the plaster.
Very well.
And most certainly.
It is foul weather in us all, sir, when thou art cloudy.
Foul weather?
Very foul.
Had I a plantation of this island, my lord?
And so it was nettle seed.
Or docks and mallows.
And were king on it, what would I do?
Well, escape being drunk for want of wine.
In the Commonwealth, I would, by contraries, execute all things. For no form of traffic would I admit, no name of magistrate. No letters should not be known. Riches, poverty, use of service, none. Contract, succession, born, bound of land, tilth, vineyard, none. No use of metal, or corn, or oil, or wine. No occupation. All men idle. All. And women too, but innocent and pure. No sovereignty.
Yet he would be king on it.
The latter end of his commonwealth forgets its beginning.
All things in common nature should bring forth, without sweat, endeavour, treason, felony, sword, pike, knife, gun, nor need of any engine would I not have. But nature of its own kind should bring forth all foison, all abundance to feed my innocent people.
What, no marrying among his subjects?
None, all whores and knaves.
I would with such perfection govern, sir, to excel the golden age.
God save his majesty.
Long live Gonzalo.
Do you mark me, sir?
Really, no more. Thou dost talk nothing to me.
Nay, good my lord, be not angry.
I promise I will not adventure my discretion so weakly. Oh, laugh me asleep. I'm very heavy.
Go sleep and hear us.
What? All so soon asleep? Would that mine eyes would with themselves shut up my thoughts. And yet, I find they are inclined to do so.
Please you, sir, do not omit the heavy offer of it. Seldom visits sorrow, when it does, it is a comforter.
We too, my lord, will guard your person while you take your rest and watch your safety.
Thank you, wondrous heavy.
Of the climate.
Why doth it not then our eyelids sink? I find myself not disposed to sleep.
Nor I. My spirits are nimble. They fell together all as by consent. They dropped as by a thunderstroke. What might, worthy Sebastiana? Oh, what might? No more. And yet, methinks I see it in thy face, what thou shouldst be. The occasion speaks thee, and my strong imagination sees a crown dropping on your head.
What, art thou waking?
Do you not hear me speak?
I do, and it is a sleepy language, and thou speakst out of thy sleep. What is it thou didst say? This is a strange repose, to be asleep with eyes wide open, standing, speaking, moving, and yet so fast asleep.
Noble Sebastiana, thou lettst thy fortune sleep. Die, rather, winkst whilst thou art waking.
Thou dost snore distinctly. There's meaning in thy snores.
I am more serious than my custom. You must be so too, if heed me, which to do. Trebles the oar.
I'm standing water.
I'll teach you how to flow.
Do so. To ebb, hereditary sloth instructs me.
Oh, if you but knew how you the purpose cherish. Whilst thus you mock it, how in stripping it you more invest it. Ebbing men indeed most often do so near the bottom run, by their own fear. Poor sloth.
Prithee, say on. The setting of thy cheek and eye proclaim a matter within, and a birth indeed, which throws thee much to yield.
Thus. My lady, although this lord of weak remembrance, this who shall be of as little memory when he is earthed, hath here almost persuade, for he's a spirit of persuasion, merely professing to persuade the king, his sons, alive. 'Tis as impossible that he's undrowned, and he that sleeps here swims.
I have no hope that he's undrowned.
Oh, out of that no hope, what great hope have you? No hope that way lies another way, so high a hope, even ambition cannot pierce a wink beyond and doubt discovery there. Will you grant with me that Ferdinand is drowned?
He's gone.
And who's the next heir of Naples?
Claribel.
She that is queen of Tunis. She that dwells 10 leagues beyond man's life. She that from whom we all were seas swallowed, though some cast again, and by that destiny to perform an act. Whereof, what's past is prologue. What to come in yours and my discharge.
What stuff is this? How say you? 'Tis true, my brother's daughter's queen of Tunis, so is she heir of Naples. Twixt some regions there is some space.
A space whose every cubit seems to cry out, how shall that Claribel measure us back to Naples? Keep in Tunis. Let Sebastiana wake. Say that this were death, that that now hath seized them. There be that can rule Naples as well as he that sleeps, lords that can prate as amply and unnecessarily as this Gonzalo. I myself could make a chuff of such deep chat. Oh, that you bore the mind that I do! What a sleep were this for your advancement! Do you understand me?
Methinks I do.
And how does your content tender your own good fortune?
I do remember you did supplant your brother Prospero.
True. And look how well my garments sit upon me. Much fitter than before. My brother's servants were my fellows. Now they are my men.
But for your conscience?
Aye, my lady. Where lies that? If 'twere a blister, 'twould put me to my slipper. But I feel not this deity in my bosom. 20 consciences that stand twixt me and Milan, candied be they, and melt ere they molest. Here lies your brother, no better than the earth he lies upon, if he be that which now he's like, that's dead. Whom I with this obedient steel, 3 inches of it could lay to bed forever. Whilst you, doing thus to the perpetual wink, for I might put this ancient morsel, this Sir Prudence, who should not upbraid our course. For all the rest, they'll take suggestion as a cat laps milk. And tell the clock to any business we say befits the hour.
Thy case, dear friend, shall be my president. As thou got Naples, I'll come by Milan. Draw thy sword, or one stroke shall free thee from the tribute that thou payest, and I, the queen, shall love thee.
Draw together.
One word.
I rear my hand. Do you the like to fall it on Gonzalo?
My master, through his art, foresees the danger that you, his friend, are in, and sends me forth, for else his project dies, to see you living. While you do hear snoring lie, open-eyed conspiracy, his time doth take. If the light keep a care, shake.
Let us both be sudden!
Good angels, preserve the king!
What? Awake?
Why are you drawn before this ghastly looking?
What is the matter?
While we stood here, securing your repose, even now we heard a hollow burst of bellowing like bulls? Lions! Did it not wake you? Oh, it struck mine in most terribly.
I heard nothing.
Oh, it was a din to fright a monster's ear, to make an earthquake. Sure, it was the roar of a whole herd of lions.
Heard you this, Gonzalo?
Upon mine honour, sir, I heard a humming. And that's a strange one, too, which did awake me. I shaked you, sir, and cried. As my eyes opened, I saw their weapons drawn. There was a noise, that's verily. It is best we stand upon our guard or quit this place. Let's draw our swords.
Lead off this ground and let's make further search for my poor son.
Heavens preserve him from these beasts.
Lead away.
He is truly in the island.
Prospero, my lord, shall know what I have done. So, king, go safely on to seek thy son.
Thank you.
on Prosper fall! You make him by inchmeal a disease! His spirits hear me, and yet I needs must curse! But they'll nor pinch me, nor frighten me with urchin show, pitch me in the mire, nor lead me like a firebrand in the dark out of my way, unless he bid him. But for every trifle they are set upon me, sometimes like apes, and mow and chatter at me and after bite me, or like hedgehogs that lie tumbling in my barefoot way and mount their pricks at my footfall. Or sometimes my all wound with adders, whom with cloven tongues do hiss me into madness. Oh, lo, now, lo, here comes a spirit of his to torment me for bringing wood in slowly. I'll fall flat. Perchance he will not mind me.
Ah, here's neither bush nor shrub to bear off any weather at all. And another storm coming. I hear it sing in the wind. Yond black one, yond huge one, looks like a foul bombard that will shed its liquor. Oh, if it should thunder as it did before, I know not where to hide my head. Yon same cloud cannot choose but to fall my hail. What have we here? A man or a fish? Dead or alive? Oh, oh, a fish. Certainly smells like a fish. A most ancient and fish-like smell. A kind of knot of the newest Paul John. A strange fish. If I were in England now, as once I was, and had but this fish painted, not a holiday fall there would give but a piece of silver. Ah, there, this monster would make a man. Any strange creature there makes a man. Ah, when they will not give a dwar to relieve a lame beggar, but they'll lazy out 10 to see a dead Indian. Legged, like a man. And fins like arms, warmer, my troth. Oh, I will let loose my opinion, hold it no longer. This is no fish, but an islander who've recently been struck down by thunderbolts. Alas, the storm, it comes again. Oh, my best bet is to hide under the creature's gabardine, for there be no other shelter hereabouts. Ooh, oh, misery acquaints a man with strange bedfellows.
I shall no more to sea, here shall I die ashore. Well, this is a very scurvy song to sing at a man's funeral. But here's my comfort. The master, the swabber, the boatswain and I, the gunner and his mate, love more Meg and Marion than Marjorie, but none of us cared for Kate, for she had a tongue like a tang, would cry to a sailor, go hang! She loved not the savour of tar nor of pitch, yet a tailor could scratch her wherever she did it. Ho-ho! Then to sea, boys, and let her go hang, go hang. Then to sea, boys, and let her go hang. Oh, this is a scurvy tune too. But here's my comfort.
Do not torment me, ho!
Oh, what's the matter? Have we devils here? Do you put tricks amongst us with savages and men of Igni, huh? I have not escaped drowning to be frightened out of your 1, 2, 3, 4 legs.
The spirit torments me.
Oh, this monster of the isle is in his fit now and does not talk after the wisest. Oh, he shall taste of my bottle. If he had never tasted wine afore, it will go sure to remove his fit. If I can recover him. Oh, and keep him tame.
Whoa!
I shall not take too much for him. He shall pay for him who hath him, and that soundly.
Thou douse me yet with little hurt, thou wilt anon. I know it by thy trembling, thou prosper works upon thee.
Come on thy ways, open your mouth. This will give honour to you. Here, come, open your mouth. This will shake your shaking, I can tell you. And that soundly. Oh, you could not tell who is your friend. Come, open your chaps again.
I should know that voice. It should be Step. Oh no, but he is drowned, and these are devils. I'll defend me.
Four legs and two voices. A most delicate monster. His forward voice is to speak well of his friend. His backward voice is to utter foul speeches and to detract. If all the wine in my bottle shall recover him, I will help his ague. Come, amen. I will pour some in the other mouth. Ah! Does that other voice call me? Oh, mercy, mercy. This is a devil and no monster. I shall leave him. I have no long spoon.
Stefano! Oh, if thou be a Stefano, touch me, speak to me. Who is I, Trinculo? Be not feared. My good friend, Trinculo!
If thou be'st Trinculo, come forth. I will pull thee by the lesser leg. If any be Trinculo's legs, these be they. Thou art very Trinculo indeed. But how came aside me the siege of this moon calf? Can he not vent, Trinculo?
I took him to be killed by a thunderstroke, but art thou not drowned, Stefano? I hope thou art not drowned. And is the storm overblown? I hid me under the dead moon calf scaffolding for fear of the storm. But art thou not living? Ah, Stefano, two Neapolitans escaped!
Oh, my, prithee, do not turn me about. My stomach is not constant.
These be fine things, and if they be not sprites, that's a brave god that bears celestial liquor. I will kneel to him.
How didst thou escape? How camest thou hither? Swear by this bottle how thou camest hither. I escaped on a butt of sack that the sailors heave overboard.
Oh, I will swear upon that bottle to be thy true subject, for the liquor is not earthly.
Swear then how thou escapest.
Oh, so I'm a shore man, like a duck, wank, wank. I can swim like a duck, I'll be sworn.
Here, kiss the bottle, though thou canst swim like a duck, wank, wank. Thou art made like a goose.
Well, Stefano, what? Is there any more of this?
The whole butt, man. My cellar is hid in a rock by the seashore, where all my wine is hid. How now, Mooncalf? How does thine ague?
Hast thou not dropped from heaven?
Oh, to the moon, I do assure thee. I was man in the moon when time was.
I have seen thee in her. I do adore thee. My mistress showed me thee and thy dog. And thy bush.
Come then, swear to that. I will fill it here anon in due course.
I will show thee every fertile inch of the island, and I will kiss thy foot. Prithee be my god.
By this light, a most perfidious and drunken monster. When God's asleep, a robbie's bottle.
Come then, down and
I
kiss.
I will kiss thy foot. I will swear myself thy subject.
Come, kiss.
I shall laugh myself to death at this puppy-headed monster, a most scurvy monster. Oh, I could find it in my heart to beat him.
Come kiss!
Ah, oh, but the poor monster's in drink. An abominable monster.
I will show thee the best springs. I will pluck thee berries. I will fish for thee. I will get thee wood enough. A plague upon the tyrant that I serve. I will bear him no more sticks, but follow thee, thou wondrous man. Wilt thou go with me?
A most ridiculous monster, to make a wonder of a poor drunkard.
I prithee, lead the way without any more talking. Trinculo, yeah. The king and all our company else being drowned, we shall inherit here. Here, bear my bottle, Trinkle, old friend. We'll fill him by and by again.
Farewell, master! Farewell!
Farewell!
Farewell! Farewell, master!
A howling monster! A drunken monster!
No more dams I'll make for fish! Ben, Ben, Kakala, Ben! Nor scrape trencher, nor wash dish! Ben! Ben, Kakala, Ben, has a new master, get a new man. Ben, Ben, Kakala, Ben, has a new master, get a new man. Ben, Ben, Kakala, Ben, freedom higher! Freedom! Freedom, Heidi, Heidi, freedom, freedom,
freedom, Heidi. Oh, brave monster, lead the way! Oh, brave monster, lead the way! Oh, brave monster, lead the way!
Some spurs unpainful, and their labors delight in them sets off. Some kind of business are nobly undergone, and most poor matters point to rich ends. This, my mean task, will be as heavy to me as odious. But the mistress which I serve quickens what's dead and make my labors pleasures. She's 10 times more gentle than her father's craft, and he's composed of harshness. I must remove some thousand of these locks and pile them up upon a sorry junction. My sweet mistress weeps when she sees me work, and says such baseness had never like executor. I forget, but this sweet thought do even refresh my labors, most busyless when I do it.
I pray you, work not so hard. Ooh, I would that the lightning had burnt up those logs you were enjoying to pile. Hey, set it down and rest you. When this burns, 'twill weep for having wearied you. My father is hard at study. Pray, set it down and rest yourself. He's safe for these 3 hours.
No, noblest mistress. The sun will set before I shall discharge what I must strive to do.
If you'll sit down, I'll bear the logs the while.
No.
Hey, give me that.
No.
I'll carry it to the pile.
No. I had rather crack my sinews, break my back, than you should shut dishonor at the gun while I sit lazy by.
It should become me as well as it does you. And I should do it with much more ease. For my goodwill is to it, and yours. It is against.
Poor worm, thou art infected. This visitation shows it.
You look wearily.
No. It is fresh morning to me when you're by night. I do beseech you chiefly that I might set in you in my prayers. What is your name?
Miranda! Oh, father! I broke your hest to say so.
Admire Miranda. Indeed, the top of admiration. Worth what dearest to the world. For several virtues have alike several women. Never any with soul and soul, but some defecting here. Did quarrel with the noblest grace she owe and put it to the foil. But you, oh, you so perfect and so peerless, are created of every creature's best.
I do not know one of my sex. A woman's face, remember. Save for my glass, mine own. Nor have I met more that I may call men than you, good friend. And my dear father, how features are abroad, I am skillless of. But by my modesty, the jewel in my dower, I would not wish for any companion in the world but you. Nor can imagination form a shape besides yourself to like of. But I prattle something too wildly. My father's precepts I dare do win forget.
I am in my condition a prince, Miranda. I do think a king, but I will not so. Hear my soul speak. The very instant that I saw you, did my heart fly to your service. There reside to make me slave to it, and for your sake, am I this patient? Look, man.
Do you love me?
Oh, heaven! Oh, earth! Bear witness to the sound. I, beyond yes. all limit of all else in the world, do love, prize, honor you.
I'm a fool to weep at what I am glad of.
Fair encounter of two most rare affections. Heaven rain grace on that which breed between them.
Wherefore weep you?
And my unworthiness, that dare not offer what I desire to give, and much less take what I should die to want. But this is trifling, and all the more it seeks to hide itself, the bigger bulk it shows. Hence, bashful cunning, and prompt me plain and holy innocence. I am your wife! Oh! If you will marry me, if not, I'll die your maid. To be your fellow, you may deny me, but I will be your servant whether you will or no.
My mistress dearest, and I, thus humble ever.
My husband, then.
I, with a heart as willing, here is my hand.
And mine, with my heart in it. And now, farewell. Till half an hour hence.
A thousand.
So glad of this as they I cannot be who are surprised with all, but my rejoicing at nothing can be more. I'll to my book, for yet ere supper time must I perform much business appertaining.
And we are three. If the other two be brains like us, let the state totters.
Servant monster, drink when I bid thee. Oh, thine eyes are almost set in thine head.
Where should they be set else? He'd be a brave monster indeed if they were set in his tail.
My man monster has drowned his tongue in sack. For my part, the sea cannot drown me. I swam, ere I could recover the shore, 35 leagues, off and on. By this light, thou shalt be my lieutenant, monster, sir!
On my standard?
Your lieutenant, if you list? Oh, he's no standard.
Mooncalf, speak once in thy life, if thou be'st a good mooncalf.
How does thy honor? Let me lick thy shoe. Thou not serve him, He's not valiant.
Oh, thou liest, most ignorant monster. Why, I am in case to Justin the Constable. Was there ever a man a coward who drank as much sack as I today? Oh, would thou tell such a monstrous lie, being but half a fish and half a monster?
Oh, how he mocked me. Will thou let him, my lord?
What, lord, quoth he? The monster should be such a natural.
low again. Fight him to death, I prithee.
Trigolo, keep a good tongue in thy head. If you prove a mutineer, the next tree. The poor monster's my subject, and he shall not suffer indignity.
I think, my noble lord, wilt thou be pleased to hearken once again to the suit I made to thee?
Marry will I. Take the knee and repeat it. I will stand, and so will Trinculo.
As I told thee before, I am subject to a tyrant, a sorcerer, that by his cunning hath cheated me of the island.
Thou liest!
Thou liest, thou jesting monkey, thou! I would my valiant master would destroy thee! I do not lie!
If you trouble him once more in his tale, then by this hand I shall supplant some of your teeth!
What? I said nothing!
Well, mum then, and no more. Come, proceed.
I say, by sorcery he got this isle. From me he got it! And if thy greatness will revenge it on him, for I know thou darest, but this thing dare not.
That's for certain.
Thou shalt be lord of it, and I will serve thee.
Wilt thou serve me, monster? No. Trinculo, do not interrupt him any more in his speech, or I'll chuck out my mercy and make a stockfish of thee.
What? I said nothing. Oh, shall I go farther off?
Did thou not say he lied?
Thou liest.
I do, do I? Well. Take now! That. As thou like this, give me the lie another time.
I did not give the lie. Out of your wits and bearing too. Oh, a pox of your bottle. Oh, this can sack and drinking do. A murrain on your monster and the devil take your fingers.
Come, forward with your tale. I prithee, stand further off.
Beat him enough. After a little time, I'll beat him too.
I prithee, stand further. In the fourth row. Come, proceed.
Why, as I told thee, 'tis a custom with him in the afternoon to sleep. There, thou mayest brain him! Having first seized his books, with a log, batter his skull! Oh. Or punch him with a stick, or cut his wizened with thy knife. But remember to first possess his books. For without them he is but a sot, as I am, nor hath not one spirit to command. They all do hate him as rootedly as I. Burn but his books. For he has brave utensils, for so he calls them, which when he has a house he will deck with all. And that most deeply to consider is the beauty of his daughter. He himself calls her a nonpareil. I never saw a woman, but only Sycorax, my dam, and she far surpasseth Sycorax, as greatest does least.
Oh, is it so brave, alas?
Aye, lord, she will become thy bed, I warrant, and bring forth brave brood.
Ooh la la! Hey! Monster, I shall kill this man. His daughter and I shall be king and queen, save our graces. Oh, and Trinculo and thyself
shall be viceroys. Dost thou like the plot, Trinculo?
Oh, excellent.
Oh, come, 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 little man. Come, give me thy hand. I'm sorry I beat thee so hard, but whilst thou livest, keep a good tongue in thy head.
Within this half hour will he be asleep. Wilt thou destroy him then?
Aye, upon my word.
Well, this I will tell my master.
You makest me merry. I am full of pleasure. Let us be junket. Will you troll the catch you taught me but while ere?
At thy request, Monster Moo, I will do reason, any reason. Come on, Twinkleos, let's have a sing-song. Oh, one, two, three. Flight em and scout em, scout em and flout em. Thought is free.
That's not the tune.
What is this saying?
Is this the tune of our catch? Played by the picture of nobody?
If thou beest a man, show thyself in thy likeness. If thou beest a devil, take it as thou list.
Oh, forgive me my sins.
He that dies pays all debts. Oh, I defy thee. Oh, mercy upon us.
I'm not afeard.
Yes. No, monster, not I. Much.
Be not afeard. This isle is full of noises, sounds, and sweet airs that give delight and hurt not. Sometimes a thousand twinkling instruments will hum about mine ears, and sometimes voices that if I then had waked after long sleep will make me sleep again. And in dreaming, the clouds, methought, would open up and show riches ready to drop upon me. Then when I waked, I cried to dream again.
Oh, this will prove a brave kingdom to me where I shall get my music for nothing.
when Prospero is destroyed.
Aye, that shall be by and by. I remember the story.
The sound is going away. Come, let us follow it, and after we can do our work.
Pretty monster, lead the way. We'll follow. With our drinks.
Hey, we'll follow.
I can go no farther. My old bones ache. Here's a maze trod indeed through forthrights and meanders. By your patience, I must needs rest me.
Old Lord, I cannot blame thee who am myself attached with weariness to the dulling of my spirits. Sit down and rest. And even here, I will put off my hope and keep it no longer for my flatterer. He is drowned, whom thus we stray to find, and the sea mocks our frustrate search on land. Well, let him go.
I am right glad that he's so out of hope. Do not for one repulse forego the purpose that you resolve to effect.
The next advantage we will take throughly.
Then let it be tonight. For now they are oppressed with travel and will not, nor cannot, use such vigilance.
I said tonight. No more.
What harmony is this? My good friends, hark.
Marvellous sweet music.
Such shapes, such gestures, such sounds, expressing, want the use of tongues, a kind of excellent dumb discourse.
There's in Naples I were to report this now, would they believe me? If I should say I saw such islanders, for certes these are people of the island,
who though they be of monstrous shape, yet note their manners are more goodly kind than many of our human generation you shall find many, even any.
Honest Lord, thou hast said well, for some of you there present are worse than devils.
I cannot too much muse.
Praise in departing.
They vanished strangely.
Well, no matter, since they left their viands behind, and
we have stomachs. Will it please you to eat what is here?
No, not I.
Faith, sir, you need not fear. When we were boys, who would have believed there were mountaineers dewlapped like bulls, whose throats had hanging at them wallets of flesh? Or there were such men whose heads stood in their breasts.
I will stand to and eat, although my last, no matter, for I fear the best is past. Sister, my lady, Duchess, stand to and do as we.
Instrument this lower world, and what is it? The never surfeited sea has seen cause to belch up you. And on this island, where man doth not inhabit, I have made you mad. And even with such like valor, men hang and drown their proper selves. Diminish one dowel that's in my plume. If you could hurt, your swords are now too massy for your strength and cannot be uplifted. My fellow ministers are like in form. But remember, for that's my business with you, that you three from Milan did supplant good Prosper, exposed unto the sea which hath requited him and his innocent child, for which foul deed the powers, delaying, not forgetting, have incensed the sea and shore, yea, all the creatures against your peace. Thee, of thy son Alonso, they have bereft, and do pronounce by lingering perdition, worse than any death can be at once, shall step by step attend you and your ways, which here, on this most desolate isle, else falls upon your heads, is nothing but heart sorrow and a clear life ensuing.
Harpy has now performed mine aerial, a grace it hath, devouring. Of my instruction hast thou nothing bated in what thou hast to say. My high charms work, and these mine enemies are all knit up in their distractions. They now are in my power, and in these fits I leave them, while I visit young Ferdinand, whom they suppose as drowned, and his and mine love darling.
Oh. In the name of something holy, sir, why stand you in this strange stare?
Oh, it was monstrous! Monstrous! Methought the billows spoke and told me of it. The winds did sing it to me. And the thunder, that deep and dreadful organ pipe, pronounced the name of Prosper. It did base my trespass, and therefore, my son in the ooze lies buried. and I will seek him deeper than e'er plummet sounded. And with him, there lie muddy. But one fiend at a time, I'll fight their legions on.
I'll be thy second.
All three of them are desperate. Their great guilt, like poison given to act a great time after, now begins to bite their spirits. I beseech you that are of suppler limbs, follow them swiftly and hinder them from what this ecstasy may now provoke them to.
Follow, I pray.
If I have too austerely punished you, your compensation makes amends. For I have given you here a third of mine own life, or that for which I live, who once again I tender to thy hand. All thy vexations were but my trials of thy love, and thou hast strangely stood the test. Here, afore heaven, I ratify this, my rich gift. O Ferdinand, do not smile at me that I boast her off, for thou shalt find she will outstrip all praise and make it halt behind her.
I do believe it, sir, against an oracle.
Then, as my gift and thine own acquisition worthily purchased, take my daughter. But if thou dost break her virgin knot before all sanctimonious ceremonies may with full and holy rite be ministered, no sweet aspersions shall the heavens let fall to make this contract grow, but barren hate, sour-eyed disdain, and discord shall bestrew the union of your bed with weeds so loathly that you shall hate them both. Therefore take heed, as Hymen's lamp shall light you.
As I hope, fair issue and long life, with such love as it is now, the murkier stand, the most opportunate place, our strongest suggestion, our worst genius can, shall never melt mine honor into lust to take away the edge of that day celebration.
Fairly spoke. There, sit, talk with her. Talk with her. She is thine own.
What, Ariel, my industrious servant, Ariel.
What would my potent master, here I am.
Thou and thy meaner fellows, your last service did worthily perform, and I must use you in such another trick. Go, bring the rabble here to this place, or whom I give you power. Incite them to quick motion, for I must bestow upon the eyes of this young couple some vanity of mine art. It is my promise, and they expect it of me.
Presently.
Aye, with the twain.
Before you can say come and go and try twice and say so-so, each one tripping on their toe will be here with mop and mow. Do you love me, master? No?
Dearly, my delicate Ariel, do not approach till thou dost hear me call. No! Look, thou be true! Do not give dalliance too much the rein. The strongest oaths are straw to the fire and the blood. Therefore, be more abstemious, or else good night your vow.
I warrant you, sir. The white cold virgin snow upon my heart abates the ardor of my liver.
Well, Eric, come! Now come! Bring a corollary rather than want a spirit. Appear and pertly. There. All eyes, no tongues, be silent.
Of wheat,
thy sea marge, sterile and rocky hard, where thou thyself dost err. The queen of the sky, whose watery arch and messenger am I, bids thee leave these, with a sovereign grace, here on this grass plot, in this very place, to come and sport, her peacocks fly amain, approach, rich Ceres, her to entertain. Drops, refreshing showers, and with each end of thy blue bow dost crown my bosky acres and unscrubbed down, rich scarf to my proud earth. Why hast thy queen summoned me hither to this short-grassed green?
A contract of true love to celebrate in some donation freely to a state on the blessed lover.
Great Juno comes, I know her by her gait.
Majestic vision, and harmoniously, charmingly, may be bold to think these spirits?
Spirits, which by mine art I have from the confines called to enact my present fancy.
Let me live here ever, so rare, wonder father and wife, make this place paradise.
Night.
celebrates a contract of true love. Be not too late.
Beast Caliban and his confederates against my life. The minute of their time has almost come. Behold, well done! Avoid no more!
This is strange. Your father in some passion that works him strongly.
Never till this day saw I him touched with
you
anger.
You do look, so my son, in a moved sort, as though you were dismayed. Be cheerful, sir! The revels now are ended. These are actors that I foretold you were all spirits. And are melted into air, into thin air. And like the baseless fabric of this vision, the cloud-capped towers, the gorgeous palaces, the solemn temples, the great globe itself, and all which it inherit, shall dissolve. And like this insubstantial pageant faded, leave not a rack behind. We are such stuff as dreams are made on. And a little life is rounded with a sleep. Sir, I am vexed. Bear with my weakness. My old brain is troubled. Be not disturbed with my infirmity. If you be pleased, retire to my cell and there repose. Turner, 2 hour walk is still my beating mind.
We wish your peace.
Come with a thought. I thank thee, Ariel. Come, Ariel. Come.
Thy thoughts I cleave to. What is thy pleasure,
Ariel? We must prepare to meet with Caliban.
My commander, when I presented Ceres, I thought to have remembered thee of this, but I feared lest I might anger you.
Where did thou leave these varlets?
As I told you, they were red hot with drinking, so full of valor that they smote the air for breathing in their faces, beat the ground for kissing of their feet, yet always bending toward their project. And so, calf like my lowing, they followed through pricking thorns and goss that entered their frail shins.
Good.
At last, I left them. In the filthy matted pool beyond your cell. They're dancing up to their eyeballs in the filthy lake.
There, this was well done, my bird. Go. Thy shape invisible, retain thou still. Go to my cell, bring the trumpery from it. For stale to catch these thieves.
I go.
This villain on whom nature, nurture will never stick. On whom my pains, humanely taken, all lost, quite lost, and as with age, His uglier face canker, so his mind will leave him. I will plague them all, even to roaring. Come, put it on the line.
Pray you, tread softly, that the blind mole may not hear a footfall. We now are near his cell.
Monster, your fairy, which you say is a harmless fairy, has done little better than play the jack with us.
Oh, monster, I do smell all of horse piss, of which my nose is in great indignation.
Oh, and so is mine. Do you hear, monster? If I should take a displeasure against you, look you!
Oh, thou wert but a lost monster.
Oh, my lord, give me thy favor still. Be patient, for the prize I'll bring thee to shall hoodwink this mischance. Therefore, speak softly. All's hushed as midnight yet.
Aye, but to lose our bottles in the pool.
There's not only disgrace and dishonor in that, monster, but an infinite loss.
That's more to me than my wetting, yet this is your harmless fairy, monster.
I will fetch off my bottle, though I be all ears for my favour.
I pray you, my king, be quiet! Seest thou here? This is the mouth of the cell. No noise! No noise! And enter. Do that good mischief which may make this island thine own forever. And I, thy Caliban, for I, thy footlicker.
Give me thy hand. I do begin to have bloody thoughts.
King Stephanie! Oh, worthy one. Oh, look what a wardrobe have we here for thee.
Let it alone, thou fool. It is but trash.
Oh, ho, monster. We all know what belongs in a frippery.
Oh, give me that gown, Finkelow. By this hand, I shall have that gown.
Now, and I, Grace, shall have it.
Dropsy, drown this fool! What do you mean to dote us on such luggage? Let it alone and do the murder first. If he wake, from toe to crown, he'll fill our skins with pinches and make us strange stuff.
I'll be you quiet, monster. Now, Mistress Line, is this not my jerkin?
Oh, monster, come, put some lime upon your fingers and away with the rest.
I'll have none on't. We shall lose our time and all be turned to barnacles or to apes with foreheads villainous low.
Monster, lay to your fingers. Help to bear these away where my coxcomb of wine is, or I'll throw you out of my kingdom. Lay to, here, carry this.
Aye, and this.
Oh, yeah, oh, and this.
Let them be hunted soundly!
Hark, they roar!
Now at this hour lie at my power all mine enemies at my mercy. Now shalt all my labors end, and thou shalt have the air of freedom. For a little follow, do me service. Now, thus my project gather to a head. My charms crack not, my spirits obey. Time goes upright with his carriage. How's the day?
On the sixth hour, my lord, at which time you said our work should cease.
I did say so when first I raised the tempest. But say, my spirit, how fares the king and his followers?
confined together, in the same fashion as you gave in charge, in the lion grove that weatherfends your cell. All prisoners, sir. Yeah. The king, yeah. His sibling, and yours. Abide all three distracted. And the remainder mourning over them, brimful of sorrow and dismay. But him that you termed the good old Lord Gonzalez, sir, the tears run down his beard like winter drops on the eaves of reeds. Your charm so strongly works in, sir, that if you beheld them, your affections would become tender.
Dost thou think so, spirit?
Mine would, were I human.
And mine shall? Hast thou, which art but air, a touch of feeling of their afflictions, and shall not myself, one of their kind, that relish o'er sharply passion as they, be kindlier moved than thou art? Though by their wrongs I am struck to the quick, yet with my nobler reason, gainst my fury, shall I take part. The rarer action is in virtue than in vengeance. They being penitent, the sole drift of my purpose doth not extend a frown further. Go, release them, Ariel. My charms I'll break, their senses I'll restore, and they shall be themselves.
I'll fetch them, sir.
Thy ales of hills, brooks, standing lakes, and groves. And ye that on the sand with printless foot do chase the ebbing Neptune, and to fly him when he comes back. You, demi-puppets, who by moonshine do the green sour ringlets make whereof the ewe not bites. And you, whose pastime is to make midnight mushrooms, that rejoice to hear the solemn curfew, by whose aid, weak masters though ye be, I have bedimmed the noontide sun, called forth the mutinous winds, 'twixt the green sea and the azured vault, set roaring war. To the dread rattling thunder have I given fire and struck Jove's stout oak with his own bolts. The strong-based promontory have I given shake, and by the spurs plucked up the pine and cedar. Graves at my command have oped, waked the sleepers, and led them forth by my most potent art. But this rough magic I here abjure, and when I have some need for heavenly music, which even now I do, to work my end upon their senses that this airy charm is for, I'll break my staff, bury it certain fathoms in the earth, and deeper than did ever plummet sound, I'll drown my book.
Settled fancy, pure thy
within thy skull.
There, stand, for you are spell-stopped. Their understanding begins to swell, and the approaching tide will shortly fill the reasonable shore that now lies foul and muddy. Not one of them that yet looks on me or yet would know me, Ariel. Fetch me the cloak of office for myself. I will discase me and myself present as I was sometime. Millen, go quickly. Spirit, thou shalt ere long be free. Why, that's my dainty Ariel. I shall miss thee, and yet thou shalt have freedom. So. To the king's ship, invisible as thou art, there thou shalt find the mariners under the hatches, the boatswain and the master. Come, bring them hither.
I drink the air before me and return, or ere your pulse twice beats.
Oh, torment, trouble, wonder, and amazement inhabits here. Some heavenly power guide us from this fearful country.
Behold, sir, king, the wronged Duke of Millen, Prospero. For more assurance that a living prince does here speak to thee, I embrace thy body, and to thee and thine companions I bid a hearty welcome.
Thou bearest he or no, or some enchanted trifle to abuse me as of late, I not know. Thy pulse beats as of flesh and blood, and since I saw thee, the affliction of my mind amends, with which I fear a madness held me. This must crave, if from this be at all, a most strange story. Thy dukedom I resign, and do entreat you pardon me my wrongs, but how should Prospero be living and be here?
First, noble sir, let me embrace thine age, whose honor cannot be measured or confined.
Whether this be or be not, I'll not swear.
Oh, you do yet taste some subtleties of the isle, which will not let you believe things certain. Welcome, my friends, all but you, my lord, my lady. Were I so minded, I here could pluck his highness's frown upon thee and justify you traitors. At this time, I will tell no tales.
The devil speaks in him.
No! You, flesh and blood, whom to call brother would in effect my mouth. I do forgive thy rankest fault. All of them. And require my dukedom of thee, which perforce I know thou must restore.
Whether thou beest Prospero or no, and if thou art, give us details of thy preservation. How thou hast met us here, this island, where we were wrecked but 3 hours ago, where I have lost how sharp the point of this remembrance is. My dear son.
I am woe for it, sir.
Irreparable is the loss, and patience says it is past her cure.
I rather think you have not sought her help, for whose soft grace I for the like loss have her sovereign aid and rest myself content.
You, the like loss?
As great to me as late, for I have lost my daughter.
A daughter? Oh, heavens. That they were living now in Naples, the king and queen there. When did you lose your daughter?
In this last tempest. I do perceive these lords at this encounter do so much admire that they devour reason, scarce think their eyes do offices of truth. But howsoe'er you have been jostled from your senses, know for certain that I am Prospero, and that very duke which was thrust forth of Milan, who most strangely upon this isle where you were wrecked was landed to be the Lord Odds. Yet, no more yet of this. 'Tis a chronicle of day by day, not a fit relation for a breakfast or for a first meeting. Welcome, sir. This cell's my court. Here have I few attendants, and subjects none abroad. I pray thee, look in. My dukedom, since you have given me again, I will requite you with as great a thing, at least bring forth a wonder to content ye as much as me, my dukedom.
Sweet lord, you play me false.
No, dearest love, I will not for the world.
Yes, for a score of kingdoms you should wrangle, and I would call it fair play.
If this be but a vision of the island, and one dear son shall I twice lose.
A most high miracle.
Though this is threatened, they are merciful. I have cursed them without cause.
And all the blessings of a glad father compass thee about. Arise, and say how thou camest here.
Oh, wonder! How many goodly creatures are there here? How beauteous mankind is! Oh, brave new world that has such people in it.
'Tis new to thee.
But tell me, who was this maid with whom thou wast at play? My oldest acquaintance cannot be 3 hours. Is she the goddess who has sundered us and brought us here together?
No, sir. She's mortal, but by mortal providence, she's mine. I chose her when I couldn't ask for my father's advice, nor thought I had one. She's daughter of this famous Duke of Milan, of whom so often I have heard renown, but never saw before, of whom I have received a second life and a second father. This lady makes him to me.
And I am hers. But oh, how oddly must it sound that I must ask my child forgiveness.
There, sir, cease. Let us not burden our remembrance with a sadness that is gone.
Oh, I have inly wept or would have spoken at this. Look down, you god, and on this couple drop a blessed crown. For it is you who have chalked forth the way which brought us hither.
Oh, I say, amen.
Who was Milan, thrust from Milan that his issue should become king of Naples? For rejoice with joy beyond common joy, and set it down with gold on lasting pillars. In one voyage did Claribel a husband find at Tunis, and Ferdinand, her brother, a wife, when he himself was lost. Prospero, his dukedom in a poor isle, and all of us ourselves, when no man was his own.
Give me your hands, and let grief and sorrow still encompass his heart that doth not wish you joy.
Be it so, amen. Oh, but look, sir, here's more of us. I prophesied if there were a gallows on land, this fellow should not drown. Now, blasphemy, thou that cursest grace o'erboard,
not an oath, I'm sure. Hast thou no mouth by land? What is the news?
The best news is that we have safely found our king and company. The next, our ship, is tight and yare and bravely rigged as when first we put out to sea.
Sir, all this I have done since I went.
My tricksy spirit.
These are not natural events. They move from strange to stranger. Say, how camest thou hither?
If I did think, sir, that I'd be full awake, I'd strive to tell you. We were dead asleep, and how we knew not, all clapped below hatches. We awaked where we beheld our royal, good and gallant ship.
Was well done.
Oh, bravely, my diligence. Go, set Caliban and his companions free. Untie the spell. How fares my gracious lord? There are yet missing from your company a few odd lads whom you remember not.
Every man shift for all the rest, and let no man take care for himself, for all is but...
But fortune. Coraggio, bully monster, coraggio.
Oh, if these be true spices that I wear in my head, here's a goodly sight.
Oh, Cerebus, these be brave spirits indeed. And if they be, that's... Oh, how fine my master is. I'm afraid he will chastise me.
What things are these, my lord Antonio? Will money buy them?
Most like. One of them is a plain fish, no doubt marketable.
Mark but the badges of these men, my lord, then say if they be true. This misshapen knave, his mother was a witch, oh, and one so strong that could control the moon, make ebbs and flows. These three have robbed me, and this demi-devil, for he's a bastard one, had plotted with them to take my life. Two of these fellows you must know and own. This thing of darkness, acknowledge mine.
I shall be pinched to death.
Is not this Stefano, my drunken butler?
He's drunk now. Where had he the wine?
And Trinculo is reeling ripe. Where did they find this grand liquor that has gilded them? Say, how camest thou in this pickle?
I've been in such a pickle since you saw me last. Ah, fear me, we'll never be at my bottle.
Why, how now, Stefano?
Touch me not. I am not Stefano, but a crab.
Thou would be king of the Isle Sierra.
I should have been a sore one then. And this is a stranger thing as e'er I saw.
He's as disproportioned in his manners as in his shape. Sirrah, go to my cell. Take with me and you, your companions, as you wish to have my pardon, trim it handsomely.
Oh, aye, that I will. I will be wise hereafter and seek for grace. What a thrice double ass I was to take this drunkard for God and worship this dull fool.
Go to, away.
Hence, and bestow your baggage where you found it.
Or stole it, rather.
Sir, I invite your highness and your train to my poor cell, where you shall take your rest for this one night, which part of it I'll waste with such discourse as I not doubt shall make it go quick away. The story of my life, and these particular accidents gone by since I came to this isle. Then, in the morn, I'll bring thee to their ship, and so to Naples, where I have hoped to see the nuptials of these, my dearly beloved, solemnized. And thence retire me to my millen, where every third thought shall be my grave.
I long to hear the story of thy life, which must Oh, most strangely on the
ears. I'll deliver all, and promise you calm seas, auspicious gales, and sails so expeditious that shall catch the royal fleet far off. Ariel, my chick, that is thy charge. Then, to the elements, be free. And fare thou well. Please you, draw near. Now, my charms are all o'erthrown, and what strength I have's mine own, which is most faint. Now, 'tis true, I must be here confined by you or sent to Naples. Let me not, since I have my dukedom got, and pardon the deceiver, dwell in this bare island by your spell. But release me from my bands with the help of your good hands. Gentle breath of yours my sails must fill, or else my project fails, which was to please. Now I want spirits to enforce, art to enchant, and my ending is despair, unless I be relieved by prayer, which pierces so that it assaults mercy itself and frees all faults. As you from crimes would pardon be, let your indulgence set me free.
Oh!